This podcast was created in collaboration for the project and with the input of photographer Christian Tiega.
The general topic which is coming back in my project is again each time finding these dotted lines.
Yeah.
So seeing that this what might appear strict divisions, there are, might be dotted lines where we can connect.
My name is Sabine Winters and you are listening to Future Based Podcast.
In a way concerning the discourse, I think if you currently look, there's a lot of things are discussed that were formerly not discussed, also in the Netherlands, but also on a global level, like the whole Me Too situation, situation in healthcare, violence that was formerly not discussed in the Catholic Church, and a lot is coming out.
Renate Schepen works as a philosopher, a dialogue facilitator, and a trainer. Currently, she's working on her PhD at the University of Vienna on intercultural philosophy. So what is intercultural philosophy about?
So I think for intercultural philosophy, one of the main points is that the philosophies from different parts of the world are considered of equal value. And there are different methods, but the philosopher I'm doing my PhD research on is a German philosopher, Heinz Kimmerle. Mm-hmm. But he had a chair in philosophy in intercultural philosophy at the Erasmus University in Rotterdam. And his method was a method of dialogue. So there was always dialogue exchange between philosophers from different cultures. And one of the things he said, he often mentioned, like, there should be an enlightenment of the enlightenment. I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah.
And he referred, and especially that was the interesting, one of the interesting things, because of dialogues with African philosophers, you start reading the Western dominant philosophical history again, and he found out that not only he, but there is a lot of racist language in, for example, Kant, in Hegel. If you read their work, they are really racist expressions in it already. And of course, this also influence, you know, their philosophies have been very influential, but this is not separated from their other ideas. And then there is this, he's a sociologist, Boaventura de Sousa Santos. He's from Portugal, but he works a lot with, but he mentions the global south. And that is not necessarily only the south, but it is voices that are often less heard. And he said, it's not necessarily the point of departure or the point of origin. It could also be the point of arrival.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and I find it very interesting because this whole project of the Enlightenment is, of course, like, the whole idea is that we would get more enlightened, but maybe many things have become obscured during this period and are still obscured, or we're maybe now only in the phase of taking this view off. But then again, you could ask yourself what gets obscured when we are, you know, because it is like the light is shifting in different areas. But of course, during the Enlightenment, there was a dominant focus on a certain type of reason. And at the same time, it was considered that it's mainly the Western male that has this certain type of reason, and therefore the philosophy belongs to them.
It appears that universities in Europe have been teaching mostly Western philosophy without giving an equal status to, for example, Chinese or African philosophies. Is this still so, or are things changing?
You see in philosophy, especially in philosophy, not only here in Europe or in the Western world, but Western philosophy, I used to study in Ghana and also in South America, and usually they are teaching in Uruguay. Usually they're teaching Western philosophy in these universities in South America or in African university.
Yeah.
And so it is really shocking. But for, like, of course, this is also changing now slowly, and it's being addressed, especially I notice in different African universities. I think South America is a little bit less fast in changing this, or less open to it yet. But what I noticed on the World Conference of Philosophy, it was really changing, and it was so fascinating. Cool. Yeah. So there was a lot of Latin American philosophers, but there was, for example, Maya philosophy, you know, the traditional philosophy, and many African philosophers, of course, because it was hosted in Beijing, there are so much Chinese philosophy, and it was not like everything had to be in English, you know, people could talk in their local language, it was translated from different languages. So I noticed, like, oh, there is something going on here and really shifting. At the same time, I noticed, you know, you see it's often related to economic power relations. So I noticed a lot of it was shifting to China. Yeah. And I also wonder, because then, for example, there are now dialogues between Chinese and African philosophers. And on the one hand, you could say, oh, you know, that might change the power relations. And because it was always, if there would be, even in intercultural philosophy, if there's a dialogue with other philosophies, it would still be like almost from a Western perspective and relating to other. That is not the intention with intercultural philosophy. But most of the conferences on intercultural philosophy, they were always taking place on the European continent. Or it was a European party hosting it. So, of course, things are changing. But so one of the questions I was asking myself is, with this global powers shift, maybe the Western dominance will become less, at least in philosophy, but also in the creation of ideas. But will it necessarily mean that it will be more equal, or will it be, do we get a new dominant area, which is maybe China? And so you always see the relation with economic factors. And on the other hand, I also noticed, like here in the academy, like there's so much discussion, and there is at least a new awareness, even though it's very slow, about like, oh, you know, almost all the philosophers we discussed, they're Western philosophers, there are male philosophers, and people are very actively discussing this and looking for different discourses. But you see also this tendency of holding on stronger to it, to protect what is there. And so I think almost sometimes I want, till a certain level we are able to discuss. But I always wonder, like, it really on an institutional level, are we really changing it? But also I'm wondering, because I see there is this change now, for example, if you look at for example fashion magazines, for a long time always the cover was this white woman with a certain, you know, body shape, and always she had to be there on the cover. And now big companies for cosmetics or magazines, they are putting black models on the covers of the magazines. They're putting sometimes models of different sizes. Doesn't always have to fit in this like standard category that is considered like standard. So it means that what it does is that ideas about beauty are shifting, and it's becoming more normal to see different types of models or women. But I always wonder at the same moment, I'm like, is this really because you know, we want to see other women, or is it also again economic interest, you know, because they want to reach a different market? So, and it is the same, so it is very of course I'm all for diversity, really for diversity, but sometimes the people ask, really actively look for some diverse person in their team from a different cultural background. But then the person is expected to adapt to the dominant culture.
Yes.
And then again, there's no real diversity. It becomes even...
It's superficial.
Yeah, it's superficial.
And marketing tooling.
So the question is, how do you get underneath that, you know? Because I also think it becomes dangerous when it's like, oh, white male is, you know, many, and then we should now all have, black women, or of course, and I'm all in favor, that there should be much more diversity, but it should go deeper than just the looks.
Of course.
So the culture you grew up in is also the carrier of the ideas and perspectives you have on the world around you. The use of language, for example, plays a very important role in structuring your environment. But why would you look for other perspectives on the world? Well, the division that seems to us to be very logical, made, for example, in ideas or by language, does not have to be logical at all. And every time you investigate another philosophy, another ideas on the world, you investigate your own relationship with this world, which might help you to come up with new ideas or maybe even solutions for problems. In this sense, to consider or to reflect on other perspectives is to reflect upon your own ideas and beliefs. And this is just what might be needed in this fragmented world, to find the dotted lines, the similarities between the differences, and to really embrace diversity.
Often there's this interesting thing in the human way of thinking. We think, and then we think there's a reality outside of us, but we don't make the connection between our thinking and the reality we created. And then with our thinking, we might create countries, which are not really there. Country borders, no, it's a human invention. But then once they are there, we think it really exists, you know, so we start believing in them. And then if you look at other philosophies, I think they could... It is just one way of structuring our world. And we very much like to structure and fragment. But if you look, for example, at African philosophies, Eastern philosophies, it's not only more holistic, it's also much more fluid. So it's not necessarily that it has to be always this strict division. I very much like the example. She's also a sociologist. Oyeronko Oyewemi, she is a Nigerian Yoruba sociologist, and she wrote a book, The Invention of Women, and I find it very fascinating because for us here, for me, also for a long time, when I see somebody, I notice I directly, not consciously, but I cannot do differently, I notice like, oh, am I talking with a man or am I talking with a woman? So I always make this division, and not necessarily I do something with it, but only already because of my language. I always have to think, do I refer to somebody as a he or as a she? Or, but even if I want to have a subscription for something, it actually doesn't matter at all if I'm a woman or a man reading it. I always need to. So this division is like really ingrained in us. And then in her book, because of the English colonizers, they there was this oral tradition, and she wrote that in the Yoruba culture, actually the first way of structuring their society was not by gender, or it was by age. So people would refer to the first child, the second child, and not necessarily to my first, like the daughter or the son, or but then the colonizer was institutionalizing the educational system in Nigeria. So they were writing many things down, and from the background they came from, it was impossible to think of a female political leader, or a female military leader, or a female priest. Whereas in the Yoruba culture, it was possible. But then on writing it down, of course, they had to decide. In the traditional Yoruba language, there's no division between. There, in the language, you don't have to say it's a she or in a he, it's a he. many traditional Latin, not Latin American, but the traditional languages in which, for example, now Mexico, they don't have this division either, you know. It's, for us, it's so logical you make the division. So what they did, everybody became a he. And maybe also not on purpose, but for them it was not possible to think about that maybe there were women that they are referring to. So all these women have been, in a way, written out of the history. But for me it's also so interesting to notice that a division that to us seems like very logical might not be logical at all. You know, that could, and if you look at age as a way to structure your society, it's much more relative, because I might be talking to you and I might be older, but I might be talking to somebody else and I might be younger. But it's not that I am talking to somebody else and I become suddenly a man, or, you know, it's a longer process. So what I want to point out with this is that each time you need to think about you become very aware that you're a relational being. You're not just like, oh, I'm this, I'm a woman and I have this age and this is what I am.
And depending on the system you're in, you're relate.
Exactly, At least I remember that there is an African philosopher, Magoba Ramose. And he has written a book about Ubuntu. And I published it in Dutch when I was working for the publishing company. And then he wrote in the cover of the book, he wrote a message for me when I handed him the Dutch version of the book. And it was, thank you for walking along with us in learning to become human. And it was so interesting that it was to become human, because it's a process of becoming. But if you look at one of the things he was describing in the book, that already our language, the way it's structured, we always have to choose between becoming or being. But when you're being, it's a static, you are. And when you're becoming, you are not, you're still in the process. So we're already making the division within that. But if you look at other language structures, it's not necessarily like that. And also he was mentioning, and that is also interesting, if you look at other language structures and other philosophies related to it, that in our way of structuring our language,
subject,
it's very important. So what I'm saying, like, who is doing, if there's no person doing it, then there's no action. So I am talking now. If I am not there, there's no talking. But you could also say talking becomes central. In other languages, the talking is central. And by coincidence, I'm participating in it and you're participating. You know, there's something happening. But because we put ourselves in the center, it also does something with our way how we look at the world, no? So maybe even using the word perspective or worldview, it's also a very Western way of thinking, because it, in the Western way, the sight has become very dominant. So when we refer to broadening, it's broadening a perspective, or we refer to worldview.
So language use is a carrier of ideas and of perspectives and structures our world. And philosophy is the investigation of these ideas and perspectives through language. The ultimate question for me is, though, what do we consider as valuable perspectives and valuable knowledge? It baffles me that we are able to discharge the intelligence of animals, for example, but do consider artificial systems that we have built as forms of intelligence.
It's all about that. It's about dominating and deciding what is knowledge, what is valuable, and from one certain perspective. And I find it's very important what you mentioned, because it's the, to me, it's very much related how we treat non-human animals. You know, that we have this hierarchy between humans and non-human animals, and we're also animals, and then, you know, we think we can dominate other animals. This it is everywhere in our system. It's so So I think in a way it could seem off topic, but it could also, there could be at some point an awareness that it's the same thing manifesting itself in many relations, in relations to other cultures, in relations to nature, non-human animals. And this is another concept by Boaventura de Sousa Santos. He talks about epistemicide.
Mm-hmm.
And I find it such a strong word. It's like knowledge systems of other cultures that might be entirely murdered.
Yeah. Mm.
Because we don't offer space for them anymore.
Yeah.
And if you think about it.
Yeah, what is knowledge? And what are the alternative ways of knowing?
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. Yeah. I think what you mentioned now, for example, Timothy Morton in his work, it's very interesting because his approach is also very cross-disciplinary.
Yeah.
So he's a philosopher, but he uses art and he doesn't make these divisions between all the different disciplines. And that if you refer to education, that is one thing our educational system does. It is cutting up the educational curriculum in different subjects, but there's also a hierarchy.
Mm.
So
natural sciences are
they are on top, and art or anything related to the body or, you know, music, or they are like, often they are facultative.
Yes.
You know, you even don't need to do it obliged, or they don't really count for your if you can pass to the next class. So it's not only that there is a division, but also that these disciplines that are so so important, especially art, philosophy, to reflect on the world, they are not considered equal to the other disciplines. And similarly, what you're saying with your philosophy education is like, maybe we learn many things, but do we learn why we learn them? What are we actually going to do with it? In which world are we going to use it? So I do think it is possible, but it's very challenging within our system, because the whole idea of this schools, university, it starts with separation. You know, you have a desk, it's already separating the top. We only use this part, you know, it's addressed at our head and our body. The rest of the body doesn't, it stays below the desk and the table, you know. And then you have the four walls of the classroom. Why are we not sitting outside, you know, learning from the nature and being in contact with it? No, we are separated from. So it is so ingrained in the whole system, but there are examples Mexico, they have different types of schools, for example, where there are alternative school systems where they are working outside, more holistic, and so there are possibilities.
Yes, let's end with this positive note. There are possibilities and other perspectives out there, and maybe the most considerable thing to do in order to work towards solutions for the world problems we are facing nowadays, is to reconsider what we value as knowledge and what we teach ourselves, but also our children, what is valuable. If you want to know more about Renate or about the project we recorded this podcast for, please visit futurebase.org.